In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As has been announced, this is one of the Sundays that are specially set apart before the coming of Lent. And they are all devoted to the Holy Spirit, for which reason, if there is no other holiday trumping them, they are in the celebrated in the red color, and the prayers and the readings all have references to the Holy Spirit. This Septuagint Sunday, which we have today, is particularly, specifically devoted to wisdom. And the strange, and perhaps in some ways not terribly relevant, long memory came to me during the Mass. When you reach the anecdotal age, as I often say, which I have, then remote, long ago events seem to somehow just pop up. Like in Hungary, we say a kefeljancsi, like just right there they are. And that was the fact that it was on this Sunday, the Sunday devoted to wisdom, that I gave my first sermon. And I was only an acolyte. So, you know, that can happen. And even a layperson can give a sermon if requested by the celebrant. And I was told, give a sermon about wisdom. So I said, all right. There was a very dear priest who was, he was a sort of semi-retired priest there in that particular parish, Father Tom Talbot, God rest his soul. He came to me, he said, well, son, you're too young to have much wisdom, but you can still speak about it. Which was quite true. I don't know whether I have acquired that much more wisdom in all those years, because this was in the early 1950s. But it is an important keynote, shall we say. It's particularly important in the Gnostic tradition, which to a very large extent is centered around the great symbolic and yet very real manifestation and embodiment of wisdom, the Holy Sophia, and which, let us say, reveals that particular quality of the deity in a special and powerful way. What is wisdom? How can we know it, whether we have a little of it or not, whether we need to acquire a good deal more of it or not, and where is it to be found? And this is not an easy question. In the famous Gnostic book, Pistis Sophia, about which I had the good fortune to be lecturing right now this month, we have the figure of wisdom, the Holy Sophia, who under very difficult circumstances, which we don't need to detail here, is constantly crying out to and affirming her confidence in and her faith in the light, in the divine light, which sees her through all these difficulties. And I think from that, and from life experience, and various other sources, we can conclude that the hallmark of wisdom in human life, in our lives, is to know what is important. What is truly and really important. And that is certainly not an easy quality to acquire. Because now, as indeed even thousands of years ago, although perhaps from age to age in always in a slightly different way, the cacophony of the voices of the world shouts at us constantly what it thinks is important. and what which really isn't. So we are bombarded with injunctions, with temptations to consider all manner of things important in this world, which may have a certain amount of little importance, but are ultimately not important at all. As the great master Gnostic of Asia, the Buddha, had so correctly pointed out, the things that this world considers important are not. Why? Well, for a variety of reasons, but one of them being that they don't last. Everything that the world holds dear, everything that the television and the radio and the governments and the various means of propaganda and publicity consider to be of tremendous importance are gone before you can even contemplate them. As the psalmist says, you know, the flower fades, everything goes, everything disappears, everything dies, everything is gone. And so certainly in that realm cannot be found that which is truly important. So where is it to be found? This is a difficult proposition, because that which is truly important is not for the most part very visible, it is not very tangible, it doesn't make any noise, and yet it is the truly important thing. In the story of Pistis Sophia, it is that light, that incredible supernal pleromic light that she has seen and that she remains faithful to, and that she keeps crying out to in the course of all of her afflictions and ultimately her return to that light in which she has trusted. And it comes to us in various ways. Two incidents come to my mind, both of them kind of sad, but illustrative of the point. The one is from my home country, from Hungary, and concerns a woman who at that time was a very old lady, a relative of mine. At one time had a beautiful, huge house with its own chapel, and all that, you know, very highly placed in society. Came the Russians and came the communists and took everything away from her. And, she was living in a little room in a little house in a village some distance from where she used to live. She was way in her 80s by then. And every Sunday morning she got up about 5 o'clock, she got her cane, and slowly she walked all the kilometers, we don't have miles over there, kilometers to the church and back. And some of the people there asked her, don't you get really tired doing that? You know, very seldom did any conveyance pass by that would have given her a ride or so. And she said, don't you know that is what is really important? Where I go, that is where the important thing is. This is the Holy Sacrament, this is nothing else really matters. Let me jump over the ocean, which is not that easy to do, to this country and to a different time, and this I did not witness myself, but one of my friends from the south side of Chicago told me, you know, in a certain suburb of Chicago, they, at some point, the in it, the government built, as they often do, something that didn't work out too well. A very frequent condition with things that governments do. If that circumstance has bypassed you so far, why, maybe you should look around. You know, in any event, it came to be called by, among the Chicagoan, the projects. Well, they were intended to be living quarters for poor people, big and tall, and in fairly short order they became not very pleasant and not very safe places. And so this person told me there also, Sunday morning, early in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, old, heavy-set, usually not very healthy old ladies. They were all of African-American black race, started their journey, and they climbed down one stair after the other, one stair, because these are very tall, they're really very tall buildings. You ask, well, weren't there any elevators? Oh yes, there were, but in the elevators were the gang members waiting, as people usually do, trying to take their little money away. Various things like that maybe hurt them, so they had to walk the stairs, and they walked the stairs, and they walked the stairs. By the time they got down on the street level, they were short-winded and weren't feeling very well, and in this one case somebody asked them, well, isn't that too much for you to do that? The lady said, young man, I'm going to worship God. Is there anything more important than that? That's what I do. You see again, these people were wise. They had wisdom, because they knew what was important and what is important. And what is important is our connection with something beyond this world, something beyond all the things pleasant and unpleasant, beautiful and ugly, good and evil that we see, beyond them, above them, transcending them. There is something there. There is something there. But we have to be aware of it. We have to cultivate it. We have to take advantage of what have been called the means of grace, the ways in which we maintain that connection. And when we do, then the gift of Sophia is in us. Whether we are Hungary, or whether we are in Chicago, or perhaps even whether we are in good old Los Angeles, good old Tinseltown. Other than that, we live a mistake. We pursue that which has no future, and the present of which is usually pretty unsatisfactory also. Now, does that mean that we shouldn't do anything else but pray all the time? Well, probably not. Because if we did that, prayer would become boring. Most anything becomes boring if we overdo it. But we have to leave room and time and energy for that which is truly important, where we call out to the light and where we cultivate our faithfulness to the light. Why? Because it is that light from whence we came. Its fragment is inside of us. And as the psalmist says, our hearts are ever restless till they find their rest in God, in the truth, in the real, in the light. And this is wisdom. Oh yes, there are wise things in books, and I'm certainly not opposed to books. You should see my front room and the immense number of books which are tumbling all over each other, even when there is no earthquake. And when there's an earthquake, I mean, that's disaster, you know. Not only the books, but the bookcases fell down last time. So, of course, there are, at best, though, the books, the scriptures, the sermons, the statements can remind us. Look, there have always been in this world people who knew what is important and who sacrificed for it and worked for it. And it kept them alive in the real life, not just the physical life, which of course is also important. I mean, we don't want to hurry it. We don't want to, and we shouldn't. And I think it's a very sad circumstance of our present culture that the number of suicides has increased so much. Even the physical life is a gift, because without that life, we wouldn't be able to sing praises to the light. We need that. But beyond that, the life, like when the Jewish people have a chai, the life, which is a very important thing. The letter that spells chai is worn like we wear the cross. Higher life, the true life, the great life. When we know that that is what is important and we pursue that, then we have done what one ought to do in this life. Yes, we have various duties, we have various opportunities, even opportunities, I said, to have fun. Sure. They are also gifts, but beyond all of that, remember that which is important. Remember where you came from. Remember where you strive to go. Remember what truly is, always was, and still is, and always will be. And you are part of that. And you have to become part of it consciously, devotedly, with determination and with energy and with faithfulness. Then you have not lived in vain. Wisdom. Sophia in Greek, sapientia in Latin. How many more languages do you want me to recite? I'll get to the ones that I won't pronounce right, you know, so I won't. But this is of extremely great importance. And so this is the quality that comes to us from way up high, comes to us through the Holy Spirit, beyond the Holy Spirit, from the great wise silence out of which all things have come, and then the fire of the Holy Spirit with the fiery tongues, and then wisdom which is potentially present within us, the Sophia who remembers the light and who calls out to the light and is faithful to the light and will be taken to the light and will be embraced and taken in. No more concerned with anything else, no more being caught up in the in the Armageddonic fields where ignorant armies clash by night. But be where we belong. Be in the true light. Be in that which is right and good. And above all, wise. Wise beyond all imaginings, because it knows. And we must know. And when we know that which knows us, the and all is well, and all manner of sin is well. Wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. And for me, the mystery of that which hangs fixed heaven and earth, descend upon us and remain with us always. Amen.